new girl watch made in China. We play ping pong ball made in China.
Hello and welcome to China Econ Talk. I'm your host, Jordan Schneider. The U.S.-China equilibrium of the past 20 years is gone, declares Gordon Orr in his recent piece on what to expect in China in 2019. So what will replace it? And what impacts will the increasingly activist Chinese government have on the broader economy and the private sector? Gordon Orr is currently a director emeritus at McKinsey, having previously helped open the firm's Beijing office and led its Greater China practice. He's currently a board member of Lenovo and Meituan Dianping. Gordon, thanks for coming on China Econ Talk.
Delighted to be here, Jordan.
So before we drill down into the economic consequences of the shifting relationship between China and the U.S., I'm curious, you know, to what extent do you think the Trump administration is justified in taking this hard line and shaking up the status quo between the two nations?
If you're talking specifically about tariffs and the justification for that, I think there's a clear spectrum of responses across different industries. If you're in the steel industry in the U.S. and you've looked at, you know, the consequences of marginally priced steel exports from China coming into the U.S. in a highly asset-intensive industry, they've been very material and they've been going on for a long time, and there's a good case to be made there. In many other sectors where it's private Chinese entrepreneurs or indeed multinationals that are exporting from China, I think the argument in favor of tariffs as a lever is pretty weak.
It seems like more and more CEOs are feeling comfortable talking about this topic, but the CEO of Rockstar Games, or Take-Two Interactive, who owns Rockstar Games, who published, you know, Red Dead Redemption and Grand Theft Auto, he's gone on record on a recent earnings call saying, you know, if we really want to fight a trade war, let's focus on the video game industry because we're losing half of our revenue to Chinese partners we have to publish with in China domestically.
Didn't the numbers for the global video game industry in 2018 come out the other day, and the Chinese industry is 2.5 times the size of the U.S. industry?
Yeah, $40 billion. Our past episode actually was just
okay. So, well, refer to the past episode. Sorry, listeners, hadn't got around to listening to the previous episode just yet. But I think businesses are more concerned about making sure they've got plans, contingency plans in place should higher levels of tariffs get put in place. At this point, most companies, I think, particularly in the electronics industry, have adjusted what they need to do to deal with the 10% tariffs on the components and the like. If things go to 25%, then you will really see these contingency plans being rolled out, and companies will be forced, I think the best way to describe it, is to reconfigure where they manufacture. Yes, it will be in part about putting new factories in outside of China, but that takes a long time to be able to source the manufacturing equipment and the like. But if you've already got a footprint that has a factory in Turkey, a factory in Poland, a factory, yeah, maybe in Vietnam or even India, you say, how can I move things around in a way that will increase costs slightly? This is not a zero cost thing to do, but it'll be better off than keeping the current footprint in place.
Sure. Hiring a handful of new workers or setting up another side shack to produce more of whatever you're producing somewhere is a much less capital intensive decision than necessarily setting up shop somewhere entirely new.
And potentially it's a less permanent decision should things, you know, swing back the other way on tariffs at some point. Plus, I think for any company that's been manufacturing at scale in China for more than a decade, you're aware that there's an enormous sensitivity to laying off workers at any point in time. It has to be handled very, very carefully in order to avoid falling out with local governments, at least.
Sure. So let's continue on this tariff topic. So you write that close to 3/4 of Chinese exports to the U.S. are intermediary goods, not direct to consumer goods. So consumers will feel the price increases largely to the extent that U.S. producers choose to pass on their higher costs. So could you talk a little bit about the firm level dynamics of who is going to take the hit for these changes?
Complicated economic forces at play here, depending on, you know, who has the leverage in the supply chain. And of course, in 2018, the exporters had some level of benefit from the depreciation of the renminbi to bail them out on a proportion of the tariffs. But, you know, most of these categories where we're talking about Chinese exporters of intermediary goods, you're probably talking about net profit margins of high single digits at most. There's a whole chunk that are going to be low single digits of the real commodity toys,
the Yiwu universe. Sure.
Exactly. That whole ecosystem there. Their ability to just suck up the tariff is zero. Mm-hmm. And although some have tried, but in the context of diminished liquidity in China in 2018, that was really hard.
Yeah.
Because you know the banks weren't there to bail you out if you were running into a cash flow problem. So the pressure on the bulk of this is being imposed on the recipients in the U.S.
Sure.
But because it's an intermediary good, there is more potential for that to be absorbed into their margin on the domestic manufacturing in the U.S. And that's more of what you've seen in the short term. You have not seen that much of the tariff increase really being passed through to the U.S. consumer.
So it's just more of a cascade where lots of different players can eat up a percent or two, and then the consumer ends up seeing it a little less obviously than they would otherwise.
The Chinese government bailing people out with the exchange rate on a percent or two as well.
So your general sense is that the short-term GDP impact in China is relatively modest, around maybe 0.5% or so, and that this, if it ends up cascading into a greater job losses and a decline in consumer confidence, will have a much larger impact. I'm curious what your general take is on consumer confidence now. And just given my general sense that the U.S.-China relationship, even if it doesn't have as much of a direct impact, has a pretty large psychological impact on a lot of these decision makers when they're thinking about hiring and or making purchases.
Yeah, the consumer confidence has been on a downward slope since about the middle of last year, but it's been a more gentle decline than I really originally expected it to be. Mm. And I think some of that's been around the fact that the job losses that have taken place have been pretty diffuse to this point in time. Mm. And, you know, the quoted number is 13 million new urban jobs were created last year. They may not have been as good a jobs. I mean, they may have largely been people, you know, working on delivery bikes and the like, so sort of marginal income, but they were there. The income tax cuts, I think, have had a positive impact. Sure. on people's mind. You know, and net, you know, salaries and incomes did rise in 2018. Okay, not as fast as they had been in the past, but most of us would be happy with a 6-7% pay rise. You know, just
most of the Western world. Sure.
Yeah, exactly. Just relative to expectations of what you've had in China in the recent past. Most people who own property show, you know, property held its value or went up slightly over the course of the year. And that's the biggest store of wealth for your average Chinese consumer. So, you know, 2018 was an okay year for your average middle-class consumer. Yes, there's all this noise and the context that you're hearing around where things could go. And I think, you know, the Chinese New Year period that's just in front of us now is absolutely critical. Of people will go away, you know, factories, businesses will shut down for this period. To what extent will all of them open up again?
Sure.
Will they open up with the same number of workers? I think we'll know with much greater certainty where we are on this by, you know, probably late February, early March.
Sure. You know, one of the big takeaways of the Trump era for me, actually, were this incredible graph that I can link to of the dramatic shifts in consumer confidence of Democrats and Republicans as soon as Trump was elected. You know, I used to believe like, okay, like GDP growth is this number, inflation is this number, unemployment is that number. So then consumer confidence, you know, you put that in and you run that regression and then you basically understand.
Yeah.
And Democrat confidence went from like 75% to 25%, and Republican consumer confidence did the exact opposite flip.
Yeah.
So, you know, even though I totally, you know, agree with the stats you're citing that, okay, property values went this much, like actually not that many people are getting fired right now, but bad noise coming into China is not a common thing, right? So when it does leak in, I mean, you can't hide the trade war story, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
It can seem to multiply in a way that may outstrip the, you know, the 0.5% of GDP that researchers came up with.
No, exactly. I mean, if you shift from listening to what people say to observing what people are doing, what the government actions are taking place right now, you know, my sense is if you add up, you know, the announced actions and the implemented actions, you know, the degree of concern that there must be at the top must be pretty high, because we're getting a lot of actions that are pushing us towards a pretty significant stimulus taking place in the economy, whether it's the bank lending being pushed through, whether it's the income tax subsidies, whether it's a VAT subsidy reduction, whether it's the relaxation on bad debt criteria in the banking systems. It's very clear that people are pulling levers and pulling them pretty hard and fast right now. So I'd say, interpreting the actions, there's a sense that, yes, in reality, consumer confidence is probably a good bit lower than is being reported.
So let's now turn to your part about the Chinese government growing increasingly activist in its economic policies.
Sure.
So you write that across all sectors, a more interventionist government is feeling confident in its ability to shape and control more and more specific details of a business, leading it to intervene through policy, regulation, and arbitrary one-off decisions. So let's stay at the more macro level before diving down into the sector-specific stuff. The way you just framed it right now didn't necessarily seem like this was coming from a place of confidence as much as a place of anxiety, no?
On the economy overall?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, I think yes, I'd agree with that assertion, that the actions that the government's taking right now on the overall economy are ones that are, you know, at a minimum, creating an insurance policy against things getting worse in the year, but more likely actually actions to address, you know, fundamental weaknesses that they see there right now.
Sure. Okay, so coming down to the sector specific side, that does seem to be a bit more of a muscle flexing. Like, we want to reimpose our vision of the way companies should behave and act towards each other. How is that manifesting itself? And in what industries do you think this is playing out most interestingly?
And probably the internet industries are going to be front and center on this. The kind of changes we're seeing now, you know, the platforms being held accountable for, you know, almost everything that takes place on their platforms, whether it's the short video, whether it's the e-commerce, whether it's the TV or film, and whether it's, you know, the IP is legitimate for it to be there, whether it's, and that's for the platform owners, for the corporates, whether you've fully implemented the requirements of the cybersecurity law.
One content regulator per every 1,000 videos uploaded. Why not, right? Well, there's a jobs program if you ever wanted one.
Well, you know, if you were in any doubt about how many people you were supposed to employ in that department, now you have an answer.
Yeah. It's funny because it was this very hysterical, depressing back and forth where wherever there'd be a scandal, like Toutiao or Tencent or whatever would announce, oh, we're hiring 10,000 new content regulators and 5,000 of them will be party members. So we're sure that they'll do a really good job when it comes to this sort of thing.
And, it's an enormous challenge for those companies. I mean, and they are being penalized for failures, which we should also highlight, whether it's fines or, you know, more significantly, whether it's, you know, particular lines of business being temporarily shut down. And there's clearly a willingness by the Chinese government to take these actions, even if they could be significantly unpopular.
Yeah.
Managing the internet is to be done in the interests of the government and the party. It's not a popularity contest.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because I think, you know, just to take games, for instance, there's competing interests within Chinese society. I'm sure 13-year-olds, if this is their first interaction with the Chinese government saying that they can't play more than an hour of games a day, like, you know, maybe that's not setting up super well for them to have a positive view of the party. But on the other hand, the parents, you know, appreciating a helping hand when it comes to them not being able to spend, you know, thousands and thousands of RMB on character skins. There are different constituencies, both within the government, within business, and then with popular society for most of these decisions, it seems.
Yeah, in the physical world, in the education space, I think what happened, you know, with the kindergarten industry after the scandal in Beijing last year of restrictions on where you could put your kindergartens, but most importantly, over time, you know, the restriction that publicly listed companies could not be invested in kindergartens going forward, so that many companies that had built up a kindergarten strategy and were planning to IPO and maybe had some secondary education activities in there, but they had to split them in two and work out what to do with a kindergarten business that now had no monetization opportunity.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because the kindergarten scandal was horrible and there were these borderline, probably relatively psychotic teachers doing mm-hmm. really bad things to children. But yeah, on the other hand, you know, there is a clear psychological benefit to having five-year-olds being in groups playing all the time. And there are plenty of studies demonstrating this pretty decisively.
Yeah, and clearly, government's intention is that kindergarten should be widely available and yeah. that as a higher proportion of Chinese children as possible get the opportunity to go to kindergartens. But in the spirit of what we were talking about a minute or two ago, they want to make sure those kindergartens not only operate to a high generic standard, but that they operate with a content and a way that's seen to be consistent with the values of the party and the government,
yeah.
you know, even at that early stage in the education system.
Yeah, but it's not like that there aren't another whole huge industry of private education going on in China outside of the kindergarten space.
Oh, so it's been a massive industry for foreign investment. I think there's now well over 1,000 international schools, just as one category of the private education system operating in China. And that it's not that the private capital or foreign capital isn't welcome. It absolutely is, in particular as a stimulus for raising standards overall and challenging the broader sector.
Sure.
But in order to continue to operate, you know, they have to be working within the red lines and the boundaries that the government is going to set for them in terms of what they teach, how they teach it, and who their teachers are.
Sure. So let's turn now to investment, since you brought it up. Chinese investment levels into the U.S., you're right, have fallen more than 70% this year and will likely fall further in 2019, as evidenced by my relatively futile job search over the last few months trying to help Chinese firms invest in the West. So I'm curious if this...
I hope the podcast pays well in that case.
Oh, no, we're ad-free here. This is a passion project. So, but any listeners out there, you heard my pitch last week. Let's keep them coming. Anyways, I'm curious if you think this change in investment is entirely due to the changing political climate, the revision of the CFIUS laws, or if there are other macro factors at play impacting these Chinese investors' decision making.
It's largely driven by the change in the CFIUS laws as the first step in the process. Because as case law under the new CFIUS system starts to work through, becomes very clear that many, many categories of investment are just completely off the table. Investments that would give access to PII, investments that give
access... What's that?
Investments that give access to personally identifiable information
sure.
on U.S. citizens... Investments that access technology, you know, are just almost certain to be turned down. And then you get into a self-censorship loop that's going on that companies will say, leadership Chinese companies will say, it's just not worth the risk of getting caught, getting the negative publicity of being in a CFIUS process and have it turned down.
Because, yeah.
you know, the end result is, and the sellers in the US are also saying, I don't want to get into a process of a sale negotiation that could run on for an extended period of time and then be turned down because not because of commercial terms, but because the government just says, I don't want you to be able to do it. So both sides are saying, no, it's not going to happen. And then that's going to radiate to other countries of saying, you know, Chinese companies will turn to other markets and say, you know, can I make alternative assets to acquire in Israel or in Europe or other tech hubs, fewer options, obviously, to do that. And, you know, a fair degree of pressure from the U.S. because, again, CFIUS scope extends beyond the U.S. So to the extent that a Chinese company making an acquisition of a European Union company that has any activity in the U.S. will require CFIUS approval for them to be able to continue to operate that part of their business in the U.S.
Sure. And at the end of the day, for almost all of these firms, the U.S. market is going to be a bigger deal than whatever investment may come from the Chinese player.
Yeah. So I think you're likely to see a shift for Chinese companies that are looking for technology to much, much earlier stage investment. You know, this is investment outside of the U.S. because in the U.S., even at early stage, it would still potentially need to go through CFIUS, that partnering with university research departments in other parts of the world, partnering, you know, with the spin-outs of universities. You know, with my UK background, I've seen quite a lot of Chinese companies showing up around Oxford and Cambridge research parks.
Interestingly, though, I think it was the news yesterday or 2 days ago that Oxford said it wasn't going to take Huawei money anymore. So even those sorts of things seem to be hemmed in by politics these days.
Indeed.
So coming back to macro for a little bit, you talked at the beginning of this podcast about the specter of layoffs and how companies have to manage them in a way that's relatively different from how a factory owner or what have you would go about doing this and managing this in other countries. So you write that ensuring manufacturing companies do not implement sudden large-scale layoffs as part of their response to U.S. tariffs should be priority number one. Any company that thinks it can get away with such layoffs should plan on leaving China entirely, as the government reaction will not be mild. Even if layoffs were part of a long-term plan made before tariffs were even thought of, it will be extraordinarily hard to persuade government officials that this is the case. So I'm curious, in what vector does this government disapproval manifest? And how exactly can the government turn the screws on you if you decide that you want to reduce your labor force?
Primarily talking about local government actions here. And it can be a whole variety of things, ranging from access to utilities that you need, sufficient water, electricity, and the like. It can be additional environmental inspections, tax audits, inspections, challenges for the expats running the factory, ease of doing business, ease of living, getting around, visa renewal, and those kind of things. Supply chain difficulties, getting products authorized to get through the docks and the like. So
the irony here sounds like the stuff you're describing is just going to want people to wash their hands of these factories entirely.
It does potentially end up creating a vicious cycle. Absolutely. But I think we've all seen those vicious cycles happen over time.
So two things you highlight as activities the government should be pursuing more aggressively than they are include redistributing fiscal resources to the struggling northeast of China, as well as investing in healthcare. I'm curious why you highlight those two as opposed to all the other things that the government could be doing right now as particularly important in your mind.
Well, the northeast China one is probably more something I've just been banging on about for a long time. Having been going up there to visit companies for well over 25 years, and seeing the transition from, frankly, it being an economic engine of China to a real backwater. You know, how many of China's top 100 internet companies are based in northeast China? Not very many. And that, you know, talent is leaving, that, you know, while there are quality universities there that are turning out quality graduates, somehow it's not creating the entrepreneurial environment. And that the local government mindset of knowing what it takes to make heavy, asset-heavy industry successful, you know, hasn't really changed sufficiently to work out what to make, you know, to make entrepreneurial asset lights, software, internet startups be successful. And I just think it's an incredibly important region in China, and you don't want a major region where the economic disparity to more successful parts of China is just continues to head in the wrong direction in such a significant fashion. So why
does that matter? Can you go a level up on that? It's like, okay, like people are moving to get more opportunities and maybe other cities have better infrastructure, and even though we have the hukou system, people are still voting with their feet for where they think governance is better and where they can earn more with their talents.
The reality is the people with the highest ability to move, in many ways, the people who are going to create the greatest entrepreneurial economic upside. And so you end up with aging population, you end up with physical infrastructure that's declining, you end up with, you know, the heavy loss-making industries continuing to prop up employment, but only, you know, through running up their debts even further. that it's not, you know, in the medium term, I just don't think it's a stable situation to have that happen. And to have it happen to an entire region just makes it even more troubling.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the moral argument becomes a lot clearer when you're literally when you're making it a lot harder to move with the hukou system than basically any other country that has depressed regions. But it's, you know, straightforward to get your kids into schools wherever you move.
There is one other economic factor that restricts movement, in that many people in these cities bought property, invested all their assets into property in those cities.
Sure.
And quality of the construction wasn't very high. And, you know, demand is not very high. So they're actually stuck with a non-saleable asset at this point. So they can't monetize their apartments to buy the new apartment somewhere else, which is creates an actually very large frictional cost for moving.
Sure. So turning now to another one of your predictions in this piece, a Japan-China grassroots reconciliation. Could you talk a little bit about the factors driving this and how you think it will manifest?
Sure. Chinese tourists would be factor number one. The desire to go visit Japan as it's become easier to go beyond Tokyo, to visit historic sites across the country, to go to the country inns and the like. Just the desire to experience that as an adjacent culture and one that, you know, physically is not very far away. Japan
flights are surprisingly expensive, though. I can't find one for under like $450. When I moved to China, I thought, man, like I'll just be hanging out in Tokyo every weekend. But it's a little farther than you think. Anyways, sorry.
The visitors to Japan, well, you know, it's in the absolute scope of Chinese tourism, may not be, you know, the dominant number, but it does create a desire and an interest and an awareness in Japanese products.
Totally.
Japanese, particularly Japanese consumer goods, everything from beauty products through to food products. And the trust in the Japanese brand of being high quality, even if the actual cost of the product is relatively low, is there. And that creates a pull that goes way beyond the people who've actually been and visited Japan.
Sure.
It radiates their out through social media and the like. At the higher end, you know, there's also the outbound desire of wealthy Chinese to buy property internationally. And Tokyo has gone way up on the radar screen recently as being relatively good value for money and a place with a large stock of property, so that the, you know, unlike in, you know, some other cities around the world, the pushback on Chinese buyers is still relatively low. Then at the grassroots level, finally, Japan and Prime Minister Abe has recognized that they really have a challenge in the number of workers. The declining workforce, domestic workforce in Japan is a real issue. They're looking to bring 500,000 workers in over the next few years. Which
is a fascinating flip. This is just, you know, this is one of the most racially pure nations in the world and has basically been having that policy for 1,000 years now. And even the handful of Koreans and Chinese who made it in Japan after World War II have been treated really poorly, been socially ostracized, not been able to get appropriate services and whatnot. So for all of a sudden a right wing prime minister to say, you know, we're going to let in not only Koreans and Chinese but Southeast Asians. I mean, get out of here, right? It's a fascinating.
Well, I think
recognition, you know, of economic reality.
Exactly, and if, you know, the current government in Japan's willing to say it's 500,000 people, you should probably say in reality that number needs to be several multiples of that, so that he's just warming people up for the fact that this is going to have to take place. And actually, you know, when you go to Japan and go to some of the fast food restaurants in Tokyo, try talking to the waiter in Chinese. There's actually quite a lot of undocumented Chinese in the low-end service markets.
Interesting.
In Japan. And then returning to the point that we were chatting on investment, there hasn't been an enormous amount of Chinese investment in tech in Japan to this point. You know, my friends at Lenovo have made several investments, whether it started with the IBM PC business and in Japan, they had a very significant operation in Japan back in the 2004-05, or more recently, investing in the NEC and the Fujitsu PC businesses that, you know, I think objectively, if you look at the market share, you know, outcomes have been pretty successful transactions and demonstrate that with the right preparations, it's perfectly possible for Chinese companies to make acquisitions in Japan and to run them successfully and add value.
So it's interesting how in Japan, you don't really see this fear of Chinese investment that you've watched developed in the U.S. over the past few years.
As long as the transaction is a friendly transaction and it's of a relatively modest size in absolute terms, business going to be fine. There clearly was some pushback around Chinese companies looking at acquiring major Japanese semiconductor companies, but that's probably right at the end of the spectrum on sensitivity.
Sure. So I wanna shout out Richard McGregor's book from late 2017 called Asia's Reckoning. Basically, it's a diplomatic history of the U.S., China, and Japan starting after the death of Mao. And one of his fascinating points that he talks about in the conclusion is that every American policymaker's like greatest fear really should be China and Japan setting aside their differences and realizing that the U.S. isn't all it's cracked up to be, that they can actually be friends. And the lack of America turning into this sort of auxiliary country for Japan, as opposed to a strong ally and an important part of Japan's future, is really concerning for U.S. interests in the region. I'm curious, how far you think this grassroots reconciliation could run?
You know, I use the word grassroots intentionally because I think it is bottom up and it is relatively modest in scale, and I'm trying to put down a marker on it right now that, you know, at the individual tourist and traveler level, things are connecting. At the I want to buy Japanese brand product, things are connecting. And that after a period where, you know, Japanese companies, I think in general, have not had the greatest success, either as using China as a manufacturing base or as a marketplace, that we could be seeing a bit of a shift, particularly on their attitude towards China as a marketplace going forward. And as Chinese, particularly technology companies, but also consumer companies, become more sophisticated and more global in scale and scope, that it will be more natural, and I think it will work, for Chinese companies to make investments in acquiring divisions or parts of Japanese companies in their sectors.
So given all we've talked about over this conversation, the increasing role of the government in the industry, the kind of sense of shifting priorities in SOEs, as well as growing influence that the central government is having on, over the past handful of years, more private, more independent companies, how do you think foreign players should think about engaging and interacting with these firms while keeping in mind the trend lines here?
You know, if your focus is on partnering with, selling to, buying from private sector companies, my counsel would be to, even in the context you just described, continue very much as you work with them in the past. Treat them as a fully commercial partner. They're trying to operate in a way that makes money for themselves over time, and that will be the dominant decision-making factor for you. If other elements come into the conversation, do try and understand their context, where it's coming from, but don't negotiate against yourself in the sense of anticipate that you have to change your way of working just because they've got a new board member or something like that.
So Gordon, you've been working in and around Chinese SOEs and private companies, you know, since the 1990s. And I'm curious if you feel like this whole world is changing. There's a lot of talk of new Cold War, of this, you know, dripping down into private sector companies. And how do you feel these changes? What's your emotional response to them? What's your advice to young folks with a foreign background and potentially different value set from Zhongnanhai working in and around this universe?
Change is an essential part of the experience of being here in China. Mm. And, you know, if you expect stability and consistency and things to be the same 3 years from now as they were 3 years ago, you come with the wrong frame of reference. That, you know, always said, you know, in doing strategy with companies in China, trying to create a five-year strategy of where you intend to go, but, you know, let's make sure we redo it in 24 months.
Sure.
Because the context will have changed. And the context can change from people getting wealthier, new sectors being prioritized and the like, but often that change is driven right from the very top in China around the tone, the policy setting, and the sort of the overall context that the very top leadership sets in terms of its attitude towards business and foreign engagement. And the era when I first came to China of the first big wave of shutdown of state-owned enterprise and the shock that created in the system, the entering WTO, and the clear theme of using foreign engagement in China to stimulate massive change in the domestic economy. The Hu Jintao era of, you know, a lot more opening up and a lot more foreign capital coming into China. And now for the last 6-7 years, a different tone in the leadership, emphasizing much more Chinese independence, Chinese self-sufficiency, it's probably a better word, Chinese leadership in many sectors and also in political realms as well. And that creates, you know, a different tone. We talked about the centralization of policymaking and oversight of implementation of policy. It creates different incentives around, you know, Chinese companies going internationally. What should they be doing and how should they be doing it? It creates potentially different market access. And I think, you know, some of that is about gives and some of it's about gets. You know, in sectors where state-owned manufacturers still dominate, some of the heavy industrial, I think it's harder, clearly harder. Some of the opening up in pharmaceuticals, taking an example, you know, has actually been remarkable over the last two years of the volume of foreign drugs that are now available for the first time to Chinese doctors, to Chinese patients, has the potential to make a really big difference in healthcare in China. The financial service opening up, people are definitely getting licenses. People are taking advantage of those. That's a positive. But on the balance of overall of gives and gets, while there's a few sectors where there's really been significant change and increased international opportunity, on balance, you're feeling more squeezed these days as a foreign company operating in China.
Yeah. So another trend I want to have your sage wisdom on is the kind of upgrade in just the general management quality of these Chinese firms. So there's been some recent commentary and criticism around foreign consultants working outside of the U.S., but one of the responses written by Tyler Cowen has argued that, quote, one of the biggest, most positive, and most neglected global trends over the past 30 years has been the spread of managerial and technocratic expertise to what used to be called third world governments. And he goes on to say, when I meet entrepreneurs in poorer parts of the world, I'm often struck by the fact that they are highly intelligent and conscientious, but they don't always understand all the cultural codes of good management. Advice that may appear stupid or trivial to more experienced observers may actually help build new cultures of business excellence and economic growth. So reflect on that, if you might.
Yeah. I think one of the things that has impressed me the most over the years working with Chinese business leaders is the pace at which they change and develop. And I think it partly comes back to their context is continuous change.
Yeah.
And so that there's an expectation that the way I run the business or what the market opportunity is 5 years from now or 2 years from now is going to be very different. You know, in the early days as an advisor manifested, you know, there was always a high level of interest in how did international companies run themselves from Chinese business leaders and from Chinese government officials too, that, you know, would open a lot of doors just to say, to explain, this is how Procter & Gamble, you know, runs itself. This is how GE runs itself in those days.
Yeah. There's an interesting, in a recent ChinaEconTalk newsletter, which you should also go subscribe to, I highlighted this piece looking at the evolution of Huawei. Yeah. And basically, they had this big decision in the mid-1990s where they were sort of at a crossroads, and the CEO decided that we're going to pay IBM consultants an exorbitant amount of money. I think it was like $600 an hour to go hang out in China and just teach us how to run a business properly. And so this this interest and this openness to Western management and Western ideas is something that's has gone back a long time, and I think you could argue is a really important factor in a lot of this growth that's happened.
And then in more recent eras, you've seen the growth in sort of really functional excellence in companies, marketing, supply chain, and the likes. Companies got bigger and bigger. And then in the really in the last 5 or 6 years, you've seen world-class excellence and innovation, particularly in terms of how they can use data to innovate their business model in ways that either isn't possible or that international companies in other countries just haven't got around to doing yet.
Sure.
And I do think to maybe I'm repeating, but it's the, being in a context of where, GDP doubles every 6 or 7 years. If you're being successful in your sector, you may be growing 40, 50% a year. It does give an enormous confidence to management that they're doing things the right way at that point in time. And it does create the basis for saying we need to change things going forward. But to comment, come back to what your quote from Tyler, I think part of what the challenge is, if you're a really, really successful entrepreneur, you're not really on the lookout for advice on problems that you haven't run into yet. And so it's only when you run into that cultural problem of, actually selling in this third country isn't like selling in wherever your home country is, for us, China. How do I do it differently? There's a tendency to assume that I know and then fail and then ask the question, rather than to assume things will be different, ask the question, and then adjust.
Do you think that's something inherent to Chinese business culture, or just inherent to successful businessmen who are getting rich really fast?
My sample set is skewed, but I would tend to believe that it's a characteristic of successful businessmen and women around the world.
Could you apply this not just to the business context? I understand you guys also occasionally do government and SOE projects. How do you think that that mindset and that has changed over the years?
Some of the most impressive, quote unquote, business leaders that I've met in China over time have actually been running cities. That with the meritocratic system that you have in China, to end up running a major city, you're a pretty talented guy. You have very clear KPIs that you're given, many of which are economic in nature. Create X thousand new jobs in this sector, create this amount of tax in this new sector. And the openness to, particularly when it's a new industry, of what does it take to attract world-leading companies? What does it take to create an ecosystem in Shanghai for the automotive sector, or in Hainan for the tourism sector? How do I make that work? You feel like the person across the table really has a very sharp business mind. Leaders of state-owned enterprises, again, I have a lot of respect for, because in many ways they must feel they've been pulled left and right over time. That there was a period when they were clearly meant to implement business according to the instructions they were given by their ministry. There was a period when, after the early IPOs, where they were given instructions that they were meant to operate as private sector companies and compete with each other. And then they were pulled back from that. And then they would make these kind of directed international investments and pulled back from that. And many of those leaders are actually in position for the 5-year cycle, which actually isn't long enough. It depends on the sector, but in the heavy industry sectors, to really make a difference, and to implement
with super long capital horizons.
I mean, if you're running a car company, the cycle of deciding to make a model, designing the model, putting it into the markets, creating commercial success, is longer than your expected tenure in the role. So you're going to focus on shorter term actions.
Sure. I mean, the city mayors also, I mean, there's that unbelievably good documentary, the Chinese Mayor, which I recommend everyone to check out on Netflix. And do you think that the term limit, you know, rotational nature of all of these jobs impacts, have you seen it impact that side as well?
Yeah, I mean, it definitely creates trade-offs because, you know, when you're there for a five-year, I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but imposing five-year limits gets people to think in five-year cycles.
Yeah.
And they're thinking about after year three, what my next role is going to be. Am I ticking all the boxes this year to get things done? So there's going to be a tendency to be less bold, less ambitious once you get to year three, four, five of someone's tenure. And certainly, why should I make a big investment in a project that the next guy in is going to get the credit for from the flag, from cutting the ribbon when it opens?
Sure. You know, we've talked a lot about trends that, you know, as someone with a relatively like neoliberal, more free market outlook, seem to be concerning, as well as a broader macroeconomic environment, which doesn't seem particularly hot right now. What would your takeaway message be here for these for this conversation?
I think private sector entrepreneurs play an indispensable role in the Chinese economy today, whether it's small, mid-sized entrepreneurs manufacturing export goods, you know, at 2% margin on the East Coast, or whether it's the internet giants that are, you know, world leading and innovating in what they do, whether it's the biotech companies and the like. And for China to continue to, as we talked about, to continue to change, you know, continue to create wealth that benefits the vast majority of people in society, needs to be a constructive coexistence between the private sector and state-owned enterprises. And you know, that balance of between the two has clearly shifted around backwards and forwards over time. And I think at the moment, private entrepreneurs are feeling under more pressure than I've noticed them feeling in the past, and many more of them less certain that there's going to be opportunities for them in China in the future. And if we're not careful, we'll end up with a bit of a vicious cycle.
Sure.
People deciding not to make investments at the margin.
Gordon Orr, thanks for coming on China Econ Talk.